Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
A reading from the book of Baruch. Take off your garment of sorrow and affliction, O Jerusalem, and put on forever the beauty of the glory from God. Put on the robe of righteousness that comes from God. Put on your head the diadem of glory of the everlasting, for God will show your splendor everywhere under heaven. For God will give you evermore the name Righteous, Peace, Godly Glory. Arise, O Jerusalem, stand upon the height, look toward the east, and see your children gather from west and east at the word of the Holy One, rejoicing that God has remembered them. For they went out from you on foot, led away by their enemies, but God will bring them back to you, carried in glory, as on a royal throne. For God has ordered that every high mountain and the everlasting hills be made low, and the valleys filled up to make level ground, so that Israel may walk safely in the glory of God. The woods and every fragrant tree have shaded Israel at God's command. For God will lead Israel with joy and the light of his glory, with the mercy and righteousness that come from him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
from Paul to the Philippians. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you. Because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now, I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think the way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart. For all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in my defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and to determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Contradictory nature of the experience is laid bare. Everyone laughs because they see the absurdity through the eyes of the humorist. Now, I think it was 2 days ago when myself and Paul and Cheryl were here at the office, and although we do make a lot of work here, we do have fun. And some, I don't know who it was, we were talking about commercials from the 1970s. And a couple came to mind, and one of them was, the jingle where you had, I think they were selling hair removal, and you had these tall, good-looking women wearing these short shorts, and they were saying, we wear short shorts. And Cheryl said that when that commercial came on, all her nephews ran to the TV. And they wondered, what does women in short shorts have to do with shaving your legs? Another one that came to mind was this woman who was wearing this slinky dress, and she was getting ready for a date, and she was selling this perfume called Anjali. And she had this skillet in her hand, and she was saying how she could cook up the bacon and fry it in the pan, and I won't say the rest. But we were laughing about that and many more, and we were like, what does that have to do with anything? Well, perhaps it did, because it sold millions and millions and millions of dollars. Now, what does it have to do with our lesson today? Those were sort of like contradictions. Before the public appearance of Jesus, a hermit preached in the desert. The preaching and the place created a sign of contradiction and a way to catch the imagination of people. John received the word of God to preach a baptism that led to the forgiveness of sins. In other words, John's baptism was symbolic. It represented a reorientation of the heart of the sinner toward God, but it did not forgive sins by itself. The baptism looked forward to an act of divine mercy at the last judgment. Somehow, in some way, the sinner hoped God would wipe the slate clean as he or she stood before the Son of Man in the last judgment. Even so, John's activity meant to fulfill Isaiah's prophecy. A desert crier called people to prepare the way of the King of Kings. The road was to be made wide, made smooth, and made new. The improvements made were internal as well as external. The center was to reform in heart and deed. Now, during this lesson today, what struck you most about the figure of John the Baptist? Was it his appearance, his preaching, or his baptism? If either. John the Baptist was God's advertisement to us. Rooted in the nation's past, his appearance in the desert caught the popular imagination of time. His message prepared the populace for the coming of one greater, so we need to get ready. The contrary sign of John brought together historical significance and prophetic tradition. It also revealed God's activity. God was about to do something new, unique, and different, and John stood in the shadows of the past but pointed to future events. And as this year ends, we too look back to the past for comfort and reflection, but we look forward to the coming of one who is greater. Let us take that time to get ready for ourselves and for the coming of the Savior. Now, at first glance, the gospel appears very short, and if one is not careful, a powerful message might get lost amidst all of the names and places that are mentioned. I will admit I first started out by making sure that I was pronouncing all of those names correctly, just in case I had to read them. After all, I was tempted to possibly preach on a different lesson, but I kept being drawn to the gospel. The pull of this lesson puzzled me that I could not see anything new in this most familiar text. Then as the week went on and I began to pray, a light appeared and the message was revealed, hidden behind all of the message from God. God chose to bypass the powerful and the elite in order to get his message across. He chose John the Baptizer to go and preach the message of baptism, repentance, and the forgiveness of sins. In this short lesson, we see that God often chooses the least of those to do the most powerful things. Most true prophets do not draw attention to themselves with their message. The attention is always focused on God. In this season of new beginnings, as we await the birth of our Savior, we get 4 weeks to spend in the water. This is our time to listen for the voice of God guiding us to be better people, to love one another as the coming Savior loves us. It is during this time in the wilderness that we have a chance to reflect on our baptism, which gave each of us a new beginning, living a life that is reflective of Jesus, and a chance to have our sins forgiven, or as one commentator wrote, a chance to be released from our sins. Prophets always need some place to go that is totally by themselves. This is their time to be alone and to reflect as Jesus did. It is during these times of isolation that God speaks to you, giving you a message that needs to be delivered to God's people. What can seem to be like an isolation or rejection is actually God preparing you to be stronger for the next mission that is asked of you. Sometimes we have to be taken away from our comfort zones in order to really see and hear what God is trying to tell and show us. This is a time that during the wild and all of its vastness and density in the place is a place where God gets our full attention. For we have no other place to go at that moment. Until you are delivered from that place and returned to the world to spread the good news of Christ. It is often during our time alone that we can reimagine our lives. We reflect on who we are and who we want to be, and more importantly, who God wants us to be. Recalling our baptism is one way to prepare ourselves for the life that awaits us outside. A baptism of repentance and forgiveness of sins is what John proclaimed in the lesson for today. To repent is to be more than just sorry for past wrongs. It is to truly change from the inside, thereby making you a better person. This change is reflected in how you treat other people, those that you do know, and more importantly, those that you do not. Those that you agree with, and more importantly, If one is truly repentant, then no words are needed. It will shine forth just like the light of Christ was meant to shine in and through each of us. A baptism for the forgiveness of sins is one that cleanses away that which still sticks to us. It releases us from past wrongs and deeds with the hope that God's grace will be enough to keep us from returning to eternity before we meet Christ. To be released from sin is also your opportunity to do that for others. If God through Jesus does that for you, then you should in turn give that gift of forgiveness to someone else. God reveals all in due time. And I repeat, God reveals all in due time. As the prophet Isaiah spoke, every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. All that has obstructed the sight of God will be removed. There will be no need for an alternative route to God. All barriers will be gone. This is what our time in the wild will do for us when God wants us to deliver the world to others. When God wants something done, then no barrier will be able to come between you and your message that God has given to you. This week, I have been thinking a lot about love. This past week, we just joined our parishioner, Ms. Hurley, and something that stuck with me was the fact that everyone I spoke to, beneath all of the words and accolades and everything else that I heard, there was a deep love running beneath that. I believe that God is good, but his love comes at a cost. We must be good to one another. I believe that many of the problems that we encounter in the world and in our own personal lives and in our church can be alleviated if we just allow the Holy Spirit to work within us, changing our hearts and attitudes so that we can be on that road to repentance and the forgiveness of sins of which the prophet Isaiah spoke. Reclaiming a baptism of repentance and forgiveness of sins often takes multiple tries. Although our baptism is a one-time event, not meant to be repeated, true repentance and forgiveness of sins can require many attempts. It is a continuing journey on an obstructed path that requires ongoing road work. The journey begins with baptism, but baptism is not so much the arrival at one's destination as it is the beginning of the journey. On this Sunday, the second Sunday of Advent, we light the second candle, which signifies love. The love that Christ will bring to us and give to us is unconditional. It prepares us for the life of him when we obey his greatest commandment, which is to love your neighbor as yourself. The love of God through his Son Jesus will prepare the way for us, straighten our paths, fill our valleys, lower our mountains, straighten the crooked, and smooth our rough paths. Just as we are waiting with anticipation for the one who will redeem the world, God is waiting for you to love one another and to follow the path that has been prepared for you. If you stay out into the wilderness for way too long, then you are not listening to God, but to yourself. The way out has been prepared for you. That way is Jesus Christ through our baptism of true repentance and forgiveness of sins. I now leave you with one of my famous questions for you to ponder over the week. Take some time this week to review this year. What were your high and low points? How did your history affect you? Now, look forward to Christmas. How can you entrust your history to the Lord? And how can you open yourself to the changes he can make? Amen. Amen. All standing, please turn to page 358 in our Book of Common Prayer and affirm the prayer. We believe in one God, the Father. Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We
Book of Common Prayer. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For millions of hunger, fear, and justice.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who miss and sick, the prisoners and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Andrew, our bishop, Daniel, our bishop-elect, for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. For Charles, Gary, John, Damian, Eddie, Gloria, Regina, Levi, Carmen, Mildred, Cherish, Reginald, Charles, Geneva, Peyton, Calvin, for our postulant Brian, and the family of Alice Hurley. Are there others? Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We exalt you. We thank you, O Lord, for all the blessings of this life.
And pray.
We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, especially Alice Hurley, for Cleveland and Pauline Sellers, for Richard and Hazel Parker. Are there others? That they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, and let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins.
Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you all for being here today. We're going to start with the most important thing, is our birthday list. We missed a birthday last week, but I think she's here today. Chris Evans, we have Tammy Smith, and Brooks Palmer. here, please come forward. And this is Mr. Charles E. Blakely, I believe. And in case you wanted, I found out your daughter told
me. Yes.
Okay. She called him.
Yes.
Okay. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we give you thanks for these servants of your church, for Charles and for Chris. I ask that you continue to keep them in good health, keep them in good spirits, continue to keep them faithful witnesses and servants of your church, and may you bless them with many more birthdays to come in the future. All this I ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I did make contact with the facilities where Tanny and where the Shiver are. Tanny's facility is open for visitation. There is no COVID restrictions at that time there in terms of people having COVID. Where Ms. Shiver is, they do offer visitation, but there is a person there with COVID. So make your decisions accordingly as to when you go to visit both of them. As you know, yesterday we said farewell to Mrs. Hurley. Full church is an understatement, but I think it was a great showing of how many people loved her and what a great impact she had on the community and our church. And she will be greatly missed. Outside, as you come in, there's a big giant toy box out there, and I think this week is the last week for you to bring a toy to support the James R. Clark Sickle Cell Foundation. St. Luke's will partner with the foundation to host a toy drive for the 2021 Giving Tree in honor of Mrs. Rudy Kanzader. The event will be held December 18th from 1 to 4 p.m. Parishioners are asked to donate a new unwrapped toy for ages 0 to 18. Gift cards for teenagers are especially needed. The foundation will provide a box that toys can be placed in before and after services. The drive will run through December 12th, that's next Sunday, and a staff member will plan to pick up the toys on Monday, December 13th. Ms. Kanzader dedicated her life's work to the cause of sickle cell disease, and the Giving Tree event held a very special place in her heart. So let us please remember to bring a toy to place in that big giant box outside next Sunday, so when they come on that following Monday, they'll need several folks to carry the box out of here. The Endowment Committee wants to remind you that on next Sunday, that they will draw the names of two individuals who contributed to the campaign from January 1st to December 12th of this year. Each winner will receive a $25 gift card, and you do not have to be present to win, and the drawing will be held in the carriage hall during fellowship hour. I want to thank you for your continued support of the Chorus to Fund. That support has gone a long way in terms of helping us to provide not only services for here, but for the various funerals that have been held here over the past few months. If you look in your bulletin, there's a nice color brochure or color poster. Tonight at 5 o'clock at Allen University, the Allen University Concert Band along with the Allen University Concert Choir will present Christmas at Allen, and that will be held in the Chappelle Auditorium. Masks are required and the admission is free, so let us go and continue to support our fellow HBCU. Next Sunday at 5 o'clock, I need my glasses, tonight at 7. Sunday at 5, the students of Angela's PR soprano will be in concert here, featuring various Christmas themes and other types of selections, and I have been drafted to sing, so if you want to come have a good laugh, come next Sunday and hear me sing. But I will say she's a very good teacher and taskmaster. And I practice every day, even though she doesn't realize it. And Sean to share something very special with me this morning, and if he's not too shy, I'd like him to come and share the meaning behind his headdress today.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Well, I don't remember the time period or the time, but my great-great, he had a great-grandmother, disguised herself to come to the U.S. It was a time where Roosevelt was actually killing the Samoans or Polynesians and the Philippines, so she decides to disguise herself to come here to start a family, or, yeah, to save us all. So that's why I'm here, because of her. So I'm just wearing this. It's her birthday, actually, today, so I'm just wearing it as homage to her.
Thank you. There is fellowship after the service. I believe we have soup and a cake to celebrate Chris's birthday. So please join us back in the parish hall after service today. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good thy vows unto the Most High.
on page 367 in the Book of Common Prayer. Would you like to pray, please?
The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to the heavenly country where with the ever blessed Virgin Mary, John, and Luke, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of the sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him